Good morning and welcome to our Eucharistic celebration. If there's anyone here for the first time or visiting, we welcome you. Today we celebrate the 34th and last Sunday of Ordinary Time. Although we may find the concept of a king to be acquainted, we can draw out a number of features which help us to understand that we are in fact ruled by the most benevolent king. We might think of a king as an example or an ideal. A king or queen shows their people own dignity and want to be freed by their dignity of sin. Christ our Lord eagerly sets us free and helps us discover our worth. Please stand as we welcome our presiding priest, Father Louis Reyes.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Good morning, brothers and sisters. Today we celebrate Christ the King. And today we really is our final Sunday in our Ordinary Time journey, where we end this year, last Sunday today, and in the next few days, the final days of Ordinary Time. And so we have the next week to really prepare ourselves to enter into the new liturgical year, which will begin on the first Sunday of Advent. And so, my brothers and sisters, there's times where we forget to let Christ reign in our life, where we let the things of this world, or maybe even the evil one, reign in our life. And so, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, ask the Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Today's Mass is being offered for the well-being of Francisco Soria and Ricardo Gonzalez, for the eternal repose of the souls of Francisco Vaca and Francisca Cervantes, and for all the holy souls in purgatory. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, whose will is to restore all things in your beloved Son, the King of the universe, grant, we pray, that the whole creation set free from slavery, may render your majesty's service and ceaselessly proclaim your praise. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we listen to the word of God.
A reading from the book of Revelation. Jesus Christ is the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by his blood, who has made us into a kingdom, priests for his God and Father, to him be glory and power forever and ever. Amen. Behold, he is coming amid the clouds, and every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. All the people of the earth will lament him. Yes, amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, the one who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty, the word of the Lord.
The Lord is King, he is robed in majesty.
A reading from the book of the prophet Daniel. As the visions during the night continued, I saw one like a son of man coming on the clouds of heaven. When he reached the ancient one and was presented before him, the one like a son of man received dominion, glory, and kingship. All peoples, nations, and languages serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion that shall not be taken away. His kingship shall not be destroyed. The word of the Lord.
Gospel according to John. Pilate said to Jesus, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?" Pilate answered, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here." So Pilate said to him, "Then you are a king." Jesus answered, "You say I am a king. For this I was born and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." The Gospel of the Lord. For me, it's really hard to understand what it means to be a king, right? What a king is. You know, when I was growing up, kings did not rule the Philippines, though we did have a dictator when I was born in the 80s. And in the United States, we never had kings here, right? And so trying to understand what a king is in our life, it's very difficult for us. Maybe if you're from another country or different place where like you actually do have kings, so maybe a little bit to understand. But really, my understanding of kings is limited to what I learned in history class and, you know, when I watch The Crown or Downton Abbey. And so totally different, right? And so today's solemnity is supposed to remind us is that Jesus Christ is supposed to be the King and the Lord of our life. If he is King of our Lord, if he is King of our life, then he is also the Lord of our life. Now, what's the Lord? What does Lord mean? The Latin word for Lord is Dominus. And Dominus is the root word that the word to dominate, or in Spanish, dominar, comes from. And so, of course, we have a very hard understanding of what to dominate means, right? And so, really, it's supposed to be the King, Jesus, is supposed to dominate our life. Not in the sense that we lose our free will, not in the sense that we lose our free will and we can't do what we want, but in the sense that Jesus dominates who we are and he's like the main thing in our life, right? He's the most dominant presence in our life. To understand what kings are, think about what a good king is supposed to do, right? A good ruler. You know, like I mentioned, in the Philippines, we had a dictator, and it was very bad. And it was through the protests that he was able to be overthrown. But to think what a good king is supposed to do. The good king is supposed to take care of his people, right? To protect them from other kingdoms, other bad things in this world, right? And when a good king protects and cares for his people, they could live in peace and they could flourish. They could fulfill their vocation in life, right? And so that's what a good king does, protects and cares for his people. Now this is the same when Christ is the king of our life, when Christ is that dominant presence in our life. When Christ is king of our life, he will care for us and protect us. Christ, in another part of the gospel, teaches us that the kingdom of God is near or is in our midst. When Christ isn't king in our life, then other things will try to dominate our life, right? Other things will try to dominate our life. Since the expulsion, the big war in heaven, when Lucifer tried to become God and God's angels fought against him and was kicked out, Lucifer, Satan, has made our kingdom, the kingdom of earth, sort of his playground. And so Satan's going to do whatever it takes to find our weaknesses, to enter into our life and dominate, try to kick God out, right? Through the work of Satan and through the fall of our parents, Adam and Eve, we are subject to sin. You know, I think everyone can agree on this. Temptation and sin, unfortunately, dominate a lot of our life, right? The goal of Satan is to divide the family, destroy their faith, and destroy their life. That's it. He's trying to take souls away from God and claim the souls for himself because he wants to be God. Satan wants to be God. And so if he could destroy somebody, destroy their faith, destroy their life, destroy their family, he has claimed that soul for himself. He will look at our weakness in our faith, our weakness in anything, and that's the entrance for him to go in. Now, what does it look like when Christ doesn't reign in our life? What does it look like when Christ doesn't dominate? Isn't the dominant presence in our life? Like I said, Satan will try to destroy us. He'll tell us lies like, you don't need God. God doesn't exist. You don't need to come on Sunday. Go watch that movie with your family. Go play football, go play whatever, right? He will tell us lies that 1 hour out of your week, just forget it. You don't need God. Or he'll tell us, you know what? You need the things of this world to make you happy. Have another shot of tequila. Go ahead and keep buying drugs. Get higher and higher, right? Pornography doesn't hurt anybody. Lies that he tells us to get us to fall into sin. And you think about it. Think of the people who are addicted to alcohol, drugs, pornography. How they've destroyed their mental health. How they've destroyed their physical health. And how they're destroying their families, if they haven't destroyed them already, right? Satan wants to destroy our lives. He will tell us lies to destroy it. Thinking of the many broken families in our community, fathers who have left their wives and children because of their failure to be responsible fathers. Think of the mothers or fathers who abused their spouse or their children. Men and women who have listened to Satan accepted the lies and destroyed their families. Think about that. No. Because God is not about division. God is about unity, especially under his kingship, under Christ's kingship, right? We're meant to be united under Christ, under that banner of love and mercy. Satan wants to divide. These are signs that we can see to understand when people do not have Christ as their king. Now, it doesn't mean we hate them, right? It doesn't mean that we hate them or we judge them like, oh, that drug addict is going to go to hell. No. That's wrong, right? We are a faith, a loving community. We're here to help them, to be present with them. A lot of people ask me, Father, you know, my brother's involved in drugs. I want to push him away from my life. You know, what do I do? Don't. Because maybe someday through your prayers, he'll have a conversion. And who's he going to turn to? You. And what happens if you push him away? He's got no one to turn to. Right? We have to love these people who have been terrible, who have fallen into deep sin. Because deep within them, they're still a son and daughter of God. Right? They're still a son and daughter of God. And that's the hope, is someday these people will hear the voice of Christ. That someday these people will begin to work with the graces God has given them. Where sin abounds, grace abounds even more. Right? So there's grace. But sometimes when we're in sin, when we're addicted, we've closed, we have blinders, and we can't see the graces. But we're hoping through our prayers, through the work of Christ and the Holy Spirit, that the graces will break through those blinders and they'll have these conversions. They'll have a change of heart. And that they'll stop listening to the voice of Satan, right? And someday, hopefully, through our help, they'll begin to allow Christ to reign in their life, to be king in their life, and to be the dominant force in their life. Now, what does it look like when Christ is the king of our life? When we allow Christ to be that dominant force in our heart, in our soul, in ourself. Whenever I celebrate today's solemnity, I always think of St. Jose Sanchez del Rio, San Jose Sanchez del Rio. He grew up during the Cristero War in Mexico. The Mexican government during this time wanted to destroy the Catholic Church. They were doing everything they could to destroy the Catholic Church. And really, if you read the history of the Cristero War and what led to it, you could see the work of Satan really trying to destroy the church in Mexico. And Mexican people are faith-filled people, right? Faith-filled, strong devotion to Our Lady Guadalupe, strong devotion to Christ the King. And yet the Mexican government tried to destroy that faith. And so St. San Jose Sanchez del Rio, 12-year-old boy, I can't even say young man, 12-year-old boy, wanting to fight. He finally joined. He was a flag bearer for the Cristeros, and he was eventually captured. 12 years, remember, 12 years old. If you have kids, imagine your kid doing this, right? He was captured. The troops, the government, the Mexican military tried to tell him, we'll let you go if you renounce Jesus Christ. If you say Jesus Christ is not king. He said, no, forget it. What did he do in prison? He prayed the rosary. He prayed for the people that was torturing him. There was another man, another Cristero that was there in prison with him, a man, an adult. He encouraged them, hey, I'll see you in heaven. 12 years old, telling a grown man, I'll see you in heaven. Stay close to Christ. Right? So the troops, they knew that he could not be turned. So what did they do? They cut the soles of his feet, forced him to walk miles to the cemetery. While he was walking, painful, bleeding feet, he prayed the rosary as he was walking. He prayed for his persecutors while he was walking. And when he finally got to the cemetery, they gave him one more chance. Renounce the faith and we'll let you live. And his final words were, Viva Cristo Rey, Viva la Virgen de Guadalupe. Long live Christ the King. Long live Our Lady of Guadalupe. Shot him twice, martyred for his faith. at 12 years old. Whenever I read a story, I think, could I even do that as a priest now? I think about that. Could I do what this 12-year-old boy did? And think about that. Can you do what this 12-year-old boy did? You know? Imagine the pain, your soul's cut out, and you're walking. And they give you one chance, renounce Christ and we'll let you live. Oh, I get to be living in peace again. But he said no. His last words, long live Christ the King, long live Our Lady Guadalupe. 12 years old. Imagine if all of our 12-year-olds, all of our teenagers had the same faith as San Jose Sanchez del Rio. They would make this, our world would change for the better, wouldn't it? Imagine. How did he get to that point? How did he have Christ the King as his point, to that point? Parent teaching him of the faith. Not just forcing him to go to Mass, but teaching him, mentoring, hey, our faith is important to us because Christ is King in my life. You know, he got involved in the church. So that's a sign, that's a huge sign that Christ is King in our life, that we're willing to die for our faith. And so what do we need to do? So today's Solemnity is really a reminder for us, my brothers and sisters. What do we need to do to allow Christ to reign in our life? To allow Christ to be the dominant force in our life? You know, even though St. Jose Sanchez del Rio suffered physical pain, his soul was safe. Because Christ reigned in his life, Christ protected his soul so that he could gain the martyr's crown, so he could gain eternal life. We have a 12-year-old in heaven praying for us because Christ dominated his life, right? As crazy as that sounds. And that's the same with us. We might go through so much pain and suffering in this world, even in the hands of other Catholics, even in the hands of other Christians. But what matters most is when Christ is the King of our life, he's going to protect our soul because Satan cannot touch our soul. And that's all we need to do, is really protect our soul. We have the sacraments. Christ gave us the sacraments to help us protect our soul. Confession. You walk out a saint after you receive absolution. You go to confession, you confess your sins, you receive absolution, you walk out of there a saint. You are a walking saint because all your sins have been forgiven. All of it. It's up to us to keep our soul pure, clean, right? And that's through working with grace, okay? And so a few questions to reflect on as I close out this homily. What are the things in our life, in our heart and our soul, that dominates our heart and our soul? Does Christ dominate our life? Or does Satan dominate our life? Giving you two signs to see how Christ dominates our life and how Satan dominates our life, right? It's really both ends of the spectrum, right? One willing to die for Christ, and the other really living this world, only this world. You know, what are the signs in our life that Christ reigns in our life? What are the signs that Christ reigns in our life? First and foremost, you're here. You're here at Mass. That's, Satan doesn't want you to receive Eucharist. Doesn't even want you to be near it, and yet you're here, right? First sign, you're there. Awesome. We still gotta work on it though, right? Including me, right? We all gotta work on it. We're gonna work on it together as a community of faith, right? And also, what are the signs that Satan's trying to get into our life? What are the addictions that we have? What are the habitual sins that we always fall into that we need to leave behind, right? We must do whatever it takes, my brothers and sisters, to permit Christ to reign in our life so that we may attain eternal life. And the beautiful thing is, like I said, where sin abounds, grace abounds even more. So that means When we're on the verge of temptation, where we're on the verge of sin, Christ is giving us graces to help us out of it. And like I said, there's blinders where we're like, I'm going to commit the sin. I'm going to do the sin. I'm going to do it. And we're hoping that our blinders are weak and those graces will come through and say, you know what? I'm not going to do this. I don't want to fall into sin because I love Christ and Christ reigns in my life. So when you're on that verge of temptation, when you're verge of sin, take a step back and allow the Holy Spirit to pull you out of there. Easier said than done, I know. Easier said than done. But if we keep practicing it, the more that we'll leave behind these sins and to allow really Christ to reign in our life. So, my brothers and sisters, may the Eucharist that we receive today, along with the intercession of our Blessed Mother and St. Jose Sanchez del Rio, grant us the graces that we need to really to permit Christ to reign in our life, to really give us the reflection that we need to look into our heart and to our soul to see where Christ is not reigning and to allow him to reign so that one day we may enjoy eternal life and meet the saints, especially the 12-year-old St. Jose Sanchez del Rio. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Let us profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. And by the Holy Spirit was incarnate the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried and rose again on the third day, according to the scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He judged the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We want Jesus Christ, our King, to rule our hearts, that we may gain wisdom and peace. As we express our petitions, we also open ourselves more completely to the ways in which our God provides for us.
For our Pope and the entire College of Bishops, that they, in the act of governing the people of God, will show the loving face of the Son of Man. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all civil servants, whether elected or not, that they will carry out their work with a clear awareness of the citizens who trust in them. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all people will accept the grace of the honest critique in the ways in which human groups divide themselves from others, that they will emphasize in our social responsibilities what all of us have in common. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For a deeper development of the respect for human life across the entire spectrum of our earthly existence, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all who are ailing and for all who address their medical needs, that they will recognize that they are a gift to each other, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the resurrection of all who have died, especially those who have died recently, and for all those whose anniversaries occur at this time, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the health and well-being of Francisco Soria, Ricardo Gonzalez, all people suffering from coronavirus and all those affected by it, for those who suffer from anxiety, depression, and cancer, for also for our brothers and sisters at home, for them let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the eternal repose of the souls of Francisco Vaca, Francisca Cervantes, and all the holy souls in purgatory, let us pray to the Lord. In a moment of silence, let us present our own petitions to our loving God. For all of these intentions and for all of our youth, that they may continue to grow in their faith through loving acts of charity, for them let us pray to the Lord. Lord Jesus, you pointed out to Pontius Pilate that the concept of king is difficult to understand and that it is not easily applied to any particular person, certainly not easy to you. Help us to recognize the many dimensions of your kingship over human hearts, that we may grow in thanksgiving for you, our suffering servant, who indeed reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated as we prepare the altar. Also, we will have a second collection to help our incarcerated brothers and sisters, and I'll speak more on that during our announcements. Be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord glorify the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
As we offer you, O Lord, the sacrifice by which the human race is reconciled to you, we humbly pray that your Son himself may bestow on all nations the gifts of unity and peace. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For you anointed your only begotten Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, with the oil of gladness as eternal priest and King of all creation, so that by offering himself on the altar of the cross as a spotless sacrifice to bring us peace, he might accomplish the mysteries of human redemption, and making all created things subject to his rule, he might present to the immensity of your majesty an eternal and universal kingdom, a kingdom of truth and life, a kingdom of holiness and grace, a kingdom of justice, love, and peace. And so with the angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy.
Clementissimi Pater, we humbly pray and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son and Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, Jose, our Bishop, and Mark, our Regional Bishop, and all those who, holding to the truth, hand on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants, and all gathered here whose faith and devotion are known to you. For them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves, and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls, in hope of health and well-being, and paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas and Damian, and all your saints, we ask that through their merits and prayers, in all things, we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation, and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands, and once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Until you come.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the Blessed Passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty, from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life, and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance, and to accept them, as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the just, the sacrifice of Abraham, our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, Almighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high, in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints, admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon. Through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord, you sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
through him and with him and in him, O God Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress. As we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, the glory are yours now. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed. For our brothers and sisters at home, let us make an act of spiritual communion. O my Jesus, I truly believe that you are present in the most holy Eucharist. I adore you above all things, and I desire to receive you to my soul. Since I cannot receive you now sacramentally, please come spiritually into my heart. I embrace you, Lord, as if you're already there. Unite myself wholly to you. Please don't allow me to be separated from you. Amen. Corpus Christi, custom in vita materna. Sanctus Christi, custom in vita materna. Thank you. Let us pray. Having received the food of immortality, we ask, O Lord, that glorying in obedience to the commands of Christ, the King of the universe, we may live with him eternally in his heavenly kingdom, who lives and reigns forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. So we're going to have a second collection today. And this second collection is to help our brothers and sisters who are incarcerated to have Bibles. Now you're wondering, why can't we just buy Bibles and just donate it to them? Well, they have to be specific Bibles, because anything could be used as a weapon in prison. So this is there's a specific company who produces Bibles for prisons, and so this is a way to help them. When I did prison ministry, even the rosaries had to be a certain type of material, Because in the past, they've been used to choke people as a weapon. Like I said, anything can be used as a weapon. So this is to make sure that, you know, our brothers and sisters incarcerated have the sacred scripture in their hand, and it's safe for them and their and the people in prison. Okay, so anything that you could donate will be greatly appreciated. They're still, like mentioned by Hami, they're still our brothers and sisters. Yes, they may have committed atrocious crimes, but they are still sons and daughters of God. And hopefully this is an opportunity for them to hear the voice of Christ, the King, in order to really have a conversion, right? We also pray for their families too, that they'll be able to be, once you know the conversion happens, they'll be welcomed back into their families. And so thank you for your generosity, and let's keep praying for our brothers and sisters who are incarcerated, and that, you know, that Christ may continue to work with them. Okay, other announcements, and then we have one announcement from our pastoral council. So I'll go through this real quick. Thanks to our community, our carnival was a success. We hope you enjoyed it. The raffle winners were, first place for the 5,000 was Clarissa Magat. She's part of the religious ed program. I think her children are part of the religious ed program. Second place for 2,500 was Angel Cruz. I believe they're involved with the school. And third place for 1,000 is Ariel Chavez. And congratulations to the winners. So it was a really big surprise. I think one of them, I don't know which one was, it was her birthday that she won the prize. And so it was a huge birthday present. I did not win any of these. How sad. I'm kidding. Okay, so this week is Thanksgiving. We have our bilingual mass on Thanksgiving Day. And so it's 10 a.m. bilingual mass. So come and, you know, pray with us. And we don't have any other masses that day. So Thursday, we normally have adoration. In the evening, it's just the mass. The offices are closed Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And that's it, okay? And so Thursday, we have mass at 10 a.m. Friday, we have nothing. No masses, no confessions. Because we want you to spend that time with your family, okay? Saturday, we have mass at 8 a.m. So if you want to go to confession, you could ask me after mass at 8 a.m. because I'll be alone. There's nobody here. Father Ernesto is going on vacation after Thanksgiving. The offices are closed. So I'll be nice and lonely here at the rectory. Don't worry, I have Thanksgiving plans. And so, but if you want to go to confession Saturday after mass, I'm open. Okay, so just talk to me after 8 a.m. mass, okay? And I'll make myself available, okay? And then Saturday, like I said, 8 a.m. and then the vigil mass for the first Sunday of Advent, 7 p.m. Okay, we are already in Advent. Oh my gosh, Christmas time is here. Thanks be to God. I'm Filipino, so I love Christmas. If you work with Filipinos, you know this. Okay, I mentioned that. Next week, we will have a special collection, a second collection, to support the Catholic Campaign for Human Development. More than 38 million people in the U.S. live in poverty. This collection supports programs that empower people to identify and address the obstacles they face as they work to bring permanent and positive change to their community. So what a great way to start the first Sunday of Advent, right, to help those in poverty. So as a family, I invite you guys to discuss this week and how you can be generous to this second collection next week. It's to help programs, not specifically people, but programs that help people in poverty. Catholic programs, okay? Catholic programs, all right? That's been approved by the church. All right, so outside, our school is doing a pre-sale for Christmas trees, real Christmas trees, not those fake ones that my parents have had for the last 30 years, like most families have, right? I swear they still have the same tree and it's like dying. It's like Charlie Brown Christmas tree. But I finally bought a Christmas tree last year from the school, and it was cool to have an actual Christmas tree. It was a pain in the butt to clean afterwards, but still, you know, it's awesome to have a real Christmas tree. So the invitation is there for you guys. The school's out there. They're selling Christmas trees, wreaths, and garlands. And so pre-order now. They're beautiful. I mean, the ones we got at the church and the ones we got at the I got for the rectory was beautiful trees. You know, let's try to have an actual Christmas where the house smells like pine. It's one thing to spray a fake Christmas tree with that pine scent, which I've done. But it's another thing to have like an actual pine tree in your home. I don't know, it just smells better. And so they'll be doing this until December 3rd. Pre-sale ends. Now, there's only a certain amount of trees that are available. So first come, first serve, or first come, first order, first whatever, all right? And so talk to the school out there, okay? And also, if you want more information about the ministry to our brothers and sisters in prison, they're outside. There's a table that they have outside. I think you saw it coming in. So if you have questions about them, what kind of Bibles they are, talk to them. They're outside. I think they only speak Spanish because the person that was supposed to come didn't come to do the English service. And so now I invite Melissa from our pastoral council to give a summary of the, you know, those that survey that all of you did? No? The two questions, shorter homilies, and Father Luis too boring. I'm just kidding. So she's gonna give a summary. The microphone's on that side, Melissa. Yeah. Yes, please. One other announcement. The store, our Guadalupanas, are selling these Our Lady Guadalupe candles for $10. And also, our store is selling nativity sets. So if you're looking for a nativity set or a way to celebrate Our Lady Guadalupe with some candles, they're on sale. If you want them blessed, I can bless them afterwards. Or Father Ernesto can. Okay, thanks.
Good morning. I'm going to go over some of the recurring themes that we saw in October survey for those of you who participated. So the first thing that came up quite often was confession, specifically the time slots offered for confession here at our parish. And so please keep in mind that we actually have more time slots than many of the other parishes in the area. But we came up with a couple of suggestions that might help ensure that everyone who wants to confess during the time slots is during the allotted time is able to. So one of the things that that we thought of was that it's a good idea to come prepared to confession and already know what you're going to say by doing an examination of conscience before you get here. And that way you go to confession and you know what you're going to tell Father, and you're not thinking as you go along. And as always, if you think you need more lengthy advice from one of our priests, you're always welcome to make an appointment with them so that you can have a little bit more time and a little bit more individualized attention. Another subject that came up often was parochial groups. And so we just want you to know that our parish offers a lot of different groups depending on your spiritual necessity. And this includes the new group that Father Louis recently initiated for young adults. So in the future, we're going to hold a fair with all the different ministerial groups so that you can get to know them better. And we also urge you to motivate your teenagers and your young people to join one of the pastoral groups at our parish. And the last topic that came up was... Actually, it's not the last one, the pastoral issues. And so one of the things that we wanted to let you guys know is that the decision whether to have Mass inside the church is going to be based on regulations established by the Archdiocese and our State Health Department. And the other thing was that there were suggestions regarding a children's liturgy during Sunday Mass, during which the children would be instructed separately. And we just wanted to say that based on our experience, our faith and liturgy is learned better in practice in unity as a family, rather than separating the kids to one area and keeping the adults in one area. So that's why we don't have a separate children's liturgy, so that we can all experience our faith together. And the other thing that came up were questions about the premises. So we do have, thanks to your generosity, we have been making improvements during the last few years. And with your cooperation, we plan on making more. Father said there are plans in the near future to improve the parking lot. And lastly, another issue that came up often was mental health. And one of the effects of the pandemic was the increase of mental health and spiritual health issues. And so we want you to know that there are resources within the church, within the Catholic Church, and also in the public health sector. So if you need guidance, you can come to the office and you can ask there, or the Archdiocese also has information. And so thank you so much to all who participated in our survey. Have a good week.
Thank you, Melissa. So for confessions, just, you know, we're one of the parishes actually has a lot of confession time, surprisingly enough, right? Because we have Tuesday and Friday from 5 to 6, but I also hear confessions during adoration after the 8 a.m. Mass on Thursday. So, and then, of course, I'm offering Saturday after the 8 a.m. Mass to hear confessions. So we're available. If you do want more advice, make an appointment with us. You know, call the office. Myself or Father Nessa will get back to you, and that'll be great. You know, that'll be easier. And yeah, come prepared to confession with the you do your examination of conscience, and prepare your kids too. Sometimes I get kids, they look at me like, I don't know, Father. Okay, cool. I don't know what to absolve. I'll just give you a blessing, you know? And so come prepared for confession. And in regards to the parking, it's cheap and easy to just do the surface, but that'll only last us a couple of years. And so the real work is going to be really digging up the parking lot and putting everything new. And that costs about $250,000 to do. And so we got to raise that, right? And so it'll be easy to do just, you know, the surface, 50,000 maybe, 40,000. It'll last us 2-3 years. And then we got to do it again. So it's a better investment to, you know, and so be patient with us with the parking. I know it's annoying. I twisted my ankle a few times walking on that. It's terrible. And I think that's it. People celebrate their birthdays this week, Thanksgiving week. Nobody born on Thanksgiving? Okay. Couples celebrating their anniversaries during Thanksgiving week? Come on, Nacho, Terry. Any other couples? Nacho and Terry. Oh Lord, I need a whole bucket of holy water. What do you guys do? We have the holy water. I need this whole thing for a notch. Oh, I got it. It's up. How many years, guys? 55. Oh my gosh. Kids? How many kids?
Four kids.
Four grandkids?
Nine.
Great grandkids?
Nine.
What? Yeah. Nine? Great grandkids? No.
Grandchildren and great grandchildren. Nine each.
Oh my gosh. Any great grandchildren?
Not yet.
Oh, awesome. Hey guys, your names?
Veronica.
And Jose? How many years?
20.
Okay. Kids?
Three
kids? No grandkids yet, right? No. Okay. All right. Okay. Face each other, hold each other's hands, look each other's eyes as we bless you guys. Good and gracious God, we give you thanks for the sacrament of holy matrimony. Continue to bless these couples as they celebrate their anniversary this year with more patience, with more love, with more graces that they need to persevere in their holy matrimony. Continue to help them be a beautiful image of what it means to be married to the church and what it means to be a couple, and that their families continue to show them love and that they continue to show love to their family. And may Almighty God bless both of you, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen. You need like 10. And yeah, just yank it out. I don't think that was enough, too. Yeah, you get that. Congratulations, guys. Kiss, beso, without the mask. Kiss. Congratulations, guys. Congratulations. right, please stand. The Lord be with you. Bow down for the blessing. May Almighty God bless you in His kindness and pour out saving wisdom upon you. Amen. May He nourish you always with the teachings of the faith and make you persevere in holy deeds. Amen. May He turn your steps towards Himself and show you the path of charity and peace. Amen. And may the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit come down upon you and remain with you forever.
Amen.
Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to God.
Have a blessed day, everybody.